Hello everyone, Pete Brooker here from Tailors With Love. I'm recording this the day after I met George Lazenby at the BFI screening of On Her Majesty's Secret Service. In this video, you'll see me meeting George very briefly, and we'll get to a Q&A with David Walliams and George Lazenby that happened after the screening. Okay, so stay tuned. It's not every day you get to meet James Bond, so I wanted to look semi-presentable. I slung on some braces in the spirit of Matera, although not the Albert Firstons. I'm still saving up for those. And they had a couple of Aston Martins on display outside the BFI in South Bank, which was really neat. This is actually my favourite car of the series. I love the symbolism of the DB5, but I think the V8 is a far more muscular looking car, originally seen in Living Daylights, of course, and you'll be able to see it again in No Time to Die. So the queue to meet George and a couple of other Bond luminaries was long, but I didn't mind that. George was charging 45 sheets per autograph, which some people might and have been quite sniffy about, but when you have opportunists rock up with 10 posters that they just bought downstairs in the lobby and have him sign everyone, then for them posters to appear on eBay the next day for 5 times the price, I mean, you know, I can see why George does it. I'm really excited, you can tell. I'm not overly fussed about getting an autograph, I'll be honest with you. I have a couple, but it's an expensive hobby and it's just not my thing. In truth, I would have just paid £45 to say hello, shake his hand and thank him for being a great James Bond. And here it is. Complimented him on his tie. It's Turnbull Asser silk jacquard, one from Tomorrow Never Dies. Of all the things I wanted to say, that was all I could muster. I mean, what a dick. By the way, silk jacquard, doesn't that sound like a fantastic henchman? I could be that henchman. I could be a tailor in the new film. I strangle people with the tape measure. It practically writes itself. Martine Beswick was there. You'll know her as Zora, the gypsy girl in From Russia With Love. She's the one in green. And she couldn't have been sweeter, and so too Carol Ashby. I already had her signature in the same book. So now onto the Q&A with David Walliams and George Lazenby. And look, if you've seen Becoming Bond, then you'll already be familiar with the story. You'll know a lot of the answers to these questions. But you might enjoy George's chemistry with David and the crowd. There was a Q&A after, and I'm going to slide that onto the podcast, which you can find a link to in the notes below. Okay, everyone, thanks for watching. Buenos Fortunas.
Gets me every time. It's really the perfect storyline for a man who doesn't want to commit in relationships. I did get married once, but she died after 10 minutes. You haven't come here this afternoon to see me. You've come to see someone I would describe, and I'm sure you agree, as a legend. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, please welcome James Bond 007, George Lazenby. How does that make you feel, George?
Well, it always does make me feel great, but I heard more men clapping than women.
it's mainly men here today. There are some men here today. There's some children. There's a lady waving. We were spotted in a commercial at first, right?
I don't know.
It's the Fry's chocolate commercial.
No. I was spotted by a casting agent who, a friend of mine double dated and I took her out. Her name was Maggie Abbott with ICM. And she started looking for me after that, and I was back in Paris. And she found me there and said, you gotta get back to London, you got something that they're looking for that the other fellas haven't got.
And what was that thing?
I'll tell you in a minute. She said, you've got something that they haven't got, and she wouldn't tell me on the phone. So I went to her office with Ken Garrity, this guy who set me up, and she made him wait outside. And I went inside, and she said, you've got arrogance. You're so fucking sure of yourself. And I didn't know what arrogance meant. I had to go and ask somebody. I think I got it on a Friday night in Australia. Everybody wanted to fight everybody, so if you stood there with arrogance, they'd leave you alone. And so I had this arrogance. And
you weren't scared at any point in the process, the casting process, that arrogance?
Well,
self-assuredness?
You don't show it, that's the trick.
Right.
All the other actors apparently showed it, that they were a little bit nervous. And I would be too if I was them. But seeing I didn't know anything about acting, I had nothing to worry about.
It's a brilliant story that you tell on that theme, which is you lied to the producers about all these films that you've done all over the world that you felt they couldn't trace. And then you came, you said, I've done films in China, or I've done films in
Afghanistan.
We had a really big film industry in the 60s. There were so many great movies coming out at that time. And then you came clean to the director, Peter Hunt.
Well, the director, he was gay. And he came all the way back from Switzerland and had his own friends over there for the weekend. And Harry, when he was interviewing me, I was shitting myself, but I wasn't showing it. And he was at his feet up on the desk, and he said, sit down. And I went over and looked out the window. I said, I'm not sitting in front of his feet. And so he got up, and he walked over to me at the window, and he said, tell me what you've done. And I said, I just told him, let him tell you. Because I couldn't remember what bullshit I said. So then he says, when's Peter Hunt coming back from Switzerland? He's over there location hunting. And he said, 3 o'clock on Friday, sir. The casting guy. He says, you, be here at 3 o'clock on Friday. I said, I can't be here.
What?
I can't be here. I was shitting myself. I want to get out of there. I thought I'm going as far as I can go. And he said, why can't you be here? I said, I'm doing a film in Paris. And he said, how much are they paying you? I said, £500 a day, which was half a year's wages. I thought, that'll get me out of here. And he says, go down and see Stanley Sapel. He'll give you £550. Be here at 3 o'clock on Friday. So I go down to Stanley Sapel, and Stanley says, what's this for? No, actor gets paid to come back. And I said, okay, see ya. And he said, no, come back here. He gave me the £550. I rang Maggie up and she said, how'd you do? I said, they gave me £550 to come back in front. George, be serious. And I was saying, what did they do? I said, they gave me, I'm coming down. Where are you? I'm in a phone box. So she came down the phone box and she's looking at the check. Couldn't believe it. And next thing I know, Peter Hunt, I'm sitting in front of him at 3 o'clock on Friday. And Peter says to me, tell me what you do. He was really pissed because his friends were in Switzerland. And I don't know what made me do it, but I looked at him and I said, I haven't spoken in front of a camera in my life. He went, what did you just say? He said, they brought me all the way back from Switzerland to see you. You haven't spoken in front of a camera in your life. And he got up and he started belly laughing around the room. And after he calmed down, he said, stick to your story, I'll make you the next James Bond. So we went over to Harry's office, and on the way across, he's asking me my life story and whatnot, and I'm giving him, I'm thinking, geez, what did I say last time? Next time, we're going up the stairs, and Cubby and Harry are at the top of the stairs. They said, get him out of here, it's a clothes peg. They'd found out that I was a male model. And so I was just about to hit the bastards for calling me out clothes peg. And then Peter says, no, I want to test him. We're going to test him at the studio. We'll be the laughing stock of the industry. He said, well, test him at your place. Test him at my place. You get the crew out there, they'll tell somebody. He said, no, I'll get Samuelson himself and a couple of guys I know will keep it quiet. So Peter obviously had a lot of clout. He edited all the other Bond films, and this was his first one he's directing. We went out to Peter's place, and the first thing they did was see if I could ride a horse. And I'd been riding horses bareback since I was this high. And so they took the saddle off, they were putting just about to put the saddle on. And I jumped on the horse and went with it with a bareback until it ran out of steam. There's no way of stopping it without a rein. And so, well, he can ride a horse. Let's see him swim. So I dived in the pool and came up the other end. And he said, no, we want to see you on top of the water. So we see you swim. So they did that, and then they got an Australian girl, Patsy Noble, to do the love scene rolling around the grass. That was fun. I thought this one thing can't be too bad.
So what was going through your head the very first day you filmed a scene as James Bond?
You know,
was it the scene of you coming up the stairs into Piz Gloria in your kilt?
The first scene I ever did was ride the horse. And then
okay.
It was all in the one day, and I had to roll around the grass with a girl and jump in the pool.
But actually and something that's in the movie, the first thing you shot that's actually in the film. Do you remember which scene?
Well, I was in the studio by this time, and United Artists wanted to see if I could stunt fight. And Harry was saying, he's Australian, he can fight, don't worry about him fighting. And I said, no, we want to see him fight. And so they set up a stunt fight. And they were doing their stunt fight, not including me. And they said, okay, let's go. And they said, you've got to miss us all by this much. And I remembered on the first two guys to miss them by that much, and the third guy, I got him. He was a Russian wrestler. I'm thinking, oh shit, when he gets up, he'll kill me. And then Harry comes by and he grabs me by the arm, steps over the Russian, takes me up against the wall. We're going with you. You tell anybody that deals off. And get out of town. Go to my travel agency, get a ticket somewhere, and get out of town. And then call me and tell me where you are. Because the press were trying to find out who was the new James Bond. And so I went back to Paris. My friends hadn't seen me for 4 months. And they said, George, what do you mean? I said, I've been working for figuring out how to get the job as James Bond in London. They said, you get it? I said, yeah. And I'm thinking, oh shit, I'm not supposed to tell them. Anyway, fortunately, they didn't believe me. And then I went down to the south of France and called up my old girlfriend, the one I went to London for. And she answered the phone and said, come down to the south of France, they can go to this travel agency and get a ticket, blah, blah, blah. And her father happened to be there. What are you going to do with my daughter down the south of France? I said, nothing I haven't done before, Jack. And she said, don't talk to my father like that. And I said, are you coming to the south of France or not? She said, yeah. So the trouble was, Harry rang up when she was on the plane on the way down. Get your ass back to London. We're going to announce you. So she gets to the airport, and I talk to her at the airport, I'll be back. I gotta go to London now. And she's thinking, what the fuck? And I get back, and they announce me as James Bond. There's no way I can get back down the south of France, because James Bond's a busy fuck.
So I just wanted to ask you, as someone who didn't have a huge amount of acting experience, or indeed any, what was going through your head? Obviously, you know, you're playing with studios, there's hundreds of people on the set, lots of actors, actresses. What's going through your head on that first day?
The first day wasn't on, it was in Switzerland.
Oh.
And there was a girl there. And she had to put her hand up my kilt and write the number. They have a room on there. So the boy said, can we have a bit of fun? And the crew. And they do like 5 or 6 takes and whatnot. And they attach this sausage to my leg.
we can't know the good stories, huh?
Sausage, it was quite large. and we expected Angela to go, and she put her hand under there, and scene was over, and all the crew were going. And she says, you've got no pants on. I said, I ain't going with her.
So what was your relationship like with the director, Peter Hunt?
None. I had no... what happened was, he had a few of his gay friends there, and they were on the set and getting in the way, and they had to lay these tracks and do things, and they were always in the way. And so they gave me the loud hailer, and they said, just say, whoever's not needed on the set, please leave. So I did. Anyone who's not needed on the set, please leave. And there was a big hailer, and Peter hadn't arrived yet. So the poor Peter's friends had to leave. And then he comes on the set, don't you ever do that again. I didn't know what I did. Apparently I got his friends to leave, and I didn't know that. I just thought I was getting rid of people who weren't needed on the set. So Peter and I never spoke from that day until the end of the film.
And did you see him after the film was made?
I saw him walk past my place. I said, hey, Peter, it's me. And he said, yes, I know. Well,
it's an extraordinary thought that you'd be directing a movie and at no point speak to the leading man.
Well, I didn't know. I'd never done a film before.
I've worked with Joanna Lundy a couple of times, and she speaks very, very fondly of you.
Me of her?
What was your relationship like with Diana Rigg?
Oh, that was unfortunate.
In what way?
Well, she said, if you don't fool around with any of the other girls, something might be able to happen between you and I. And the first day I was with the receptionist at the hotel in the stuntman's tent. And Diana was walking up the path to the hotel. And as soon as she got right beside me, they lifted the side of the tent. I said, hello. And, you know.
She wasn't impressed.
Not at all.
Funny that. Antelli Savalas is, for a lot of people, the best bloke of all. What was your experience like of working with him?
What?
What was your experience like of working with Telly Savalas?
Oh, he was, Telly Savalas. It is full of Telly Savalas. And he, I remember once I was in the office where you get your per diem, and I was getting $100 a week. And Harry happened to walk in this day. I looked at the accountant, and I said, how much is the other fella getting? I used to call him the other fella. And he looked at Harry, and I looked at Harry. I said, doing the same shit. And so he said, okay, give it to him, $1,000 a week.
And what were you being paid to make the whole movie?
10,000.
So you were getting more a week as in per diems than your.
I was getting making the movie.
That's pretty unusual.
I'm saying, but I didn't know how much actors got. I had no idea, and I didn't even discuss my wages. They just told me what I was getting.
And of course, the film is so famous for this very unusual ending for a Bond film, this downbeat ending. Such an emotional scene. What are your memories of filming that scene?
Well, I'd been working 9 months, and I learned how to feel emotion and do emotion. And tears were flowing down my face when I was holding Diana after she was shot. And Peter Hunt said, "Cut! James Bond doesn't cry." Took the tears away. I thought it was a much stronger scene. But I did it again without the tears. And that never happened to the other fellow. But I used to say that all the time, that this never happened to the other fellow. They'd have, I was jumping out of helicopters 20 foot above the thing, and then Peter Hunt was, I heard, said to one of the stuntmen, "Don't worry, if we kill him, no one's seen him yet." So I was on that, I was doing it in a different way.
And that's why the movie, that's why the line, "This never happens to the other fella," is in the movie, because...
I used to say to him, "I bet you the other guy didn't have to do this." You know, I'd hang off ropes and stuff and jumping out of helicopters and everything but the skiing. I wasn't allowed to do the skiing. The insurance saw skiing and they said, no, actor, lead actors mustn't ski. Of course I did, but that was on my own.